let's sing how great thou art. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the world's hands above, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul,
celebrate it, and that Dave is more alive than we could ever be. I thank you that he's in your presence, and that we're here because we love you and we love him. And so as we celebrate Christ and as we celebrate Dave this morning, may it not only glorify you, but also honor him. And as we reflect on the goodness and the greatness of your grace in Dave's life, may it have an impact on our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. We're here to celebrate Dave. Isn't that great?
Yeah.
Dave's worth celebrating. In fact, Dave made me an uncle before I was ever born. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Jackie's brother. She's the oldest in the family. I'm the youngest. And just through a number of circumstances, as life unfolded, Jackie and Dave became grandparents to our three kids and now our 11 grandkids. And I think there were probably 18 out of 20 summers that we were at Lake Arrowhead for a couple weeks at a time. And then we'd often visit them, and I loved beating them at cards. That was always fun. And just playing games with them, just eating, just being together. We just love these guys. And we have a lot to celebrate today. What we're gonna do is there'll be four family members that are gonna be sharing this morning. And then at Rachel's house, Rachel Nick's home, when we go there for a celebration afterwards, a reception, we'll have opportunity for others to share there. So. We'd like to give you that opportunity later. So we'd just like to thank you for being here, and you're here because you love Dave. And let me encourage you, he loves you. He loves you. So that's very, very important to know. At this time, we're gonna hear from Kathy and Susan. And so if they'd come up, and then when they're done, Kim and Karen will be coming up, and then we're going to have another song.
I'll go first?
Yeah, you go first.
All right. So I'm just going to tell you that my dad was born in Illinois, and he met my mom at church, and he went into the Navy after finishing his schooling. And when he came home, he reconnected with my mom. And as she says, and he says, well, he says she was the prettiest girl in Chicago. And he was so happy to marry and live with her for 74 years of marriage. And they had two children, and I was blessed to be number three. So Terry was the oldest, and he drowned when I was a baby. And my sister Cheryl went to heaven 2 years ago. And I'm brokenhearted to talk to, and I talk to her every day when I read my Bible and pray. I also remember two children that my parents took care of, and they cared for them as their own. I remember that my dad put a swing set in the basement in Illinois so that we could swing and play even during the snowy winters. We moved to Indiana, and Dad worked for Minneapolis Moline and Alice Chalmers selling farm implements. And I remember going to the county fairs and sitting on the hay bales, wearing cowboy hats while Dad worked in the sales booth. And I remember one time Dad took us ice skating, and he was helping me put on my skates, and I couldn't get my foot in, and he was holding that skate, and he said, push. So I pushed my foot in, and he said, no, push harder. So I pushed really hard, and the skate slipped out of his hands, and the blade tip went right into his forehead. So I always remember looking at that hole in his forehead and thinking, oh my gosh, that was from my skate. And I remember my dad having his band friends over and practicing their sets to play at the local bars. And Cheryl and I thought it was a concert just for us, and we danced all over and just had a great time. And then when I was 10, we moved to California. And I rode with my dad in the moving van to keep him awake because I was such a great talker. So our family life changed for the better when we moved to Arcadia, and we started going to Arcadia Community Church. When I was in junior high, I was on the drill team. And I always remember my dad coming to the Temple City Camellia Parade and watching me march by. That was the only parade I remember marching in because my dad was there cheering for me. My dad's faith was evident in all he did. I felt and saw that Jesus Christ was truly Lord of his life. My first year of high school, we moved to Pasadena, and we joined Lake Avenue Church. And Dad would go to Skid Row, and he'd preach at the Union Rescue Mission. And he joined with the Gideons in distributing Bibles. Our garage was, we had pallets of Bibles in the garage. And he gave missionaries cars and money, and he always hired men that were trying to make a new start and turn their lives around. He was all for helping people. And we always had people staying at our home. We called it the Kennedy Hilton. Dad not only had strong beliefs, he lived his faith. He was the spiritual head of our home, hardworking, honorable, and he was a wonderful provider. We went on family vacations. We had a mobile home at a ranch by Santa Barbara. We had a vacation home at Lake Arrowhead where we spent our summers. And one of my fondest memories was Dad and me taking a road trip to Colorado in 2007. I kept asking Dad to help let me drive, and he said, I'm fine. He drove the whole way. But we had such a great time together. I remember talking. We had hours together in the car, and I told him my mistakes and hurts and disappointments, and he just drove on and listened as I confessed my past sins and strongholds. I felt a huge weight lifted and delivered from sin and shame that day. He never put me down or counted it against me. My dad was such a great example of showing the love of Jesus, and he wanted our family to know, love, and follow Jesus as their Lord and Savior. He was intentional about keeping Jesus Christ first and foremost in his life and sharing with me and others that Jesus is the way to true peace and happiness. Every time us kids would fight, he would tell us, "You need to love one another." And I realize how blessed I am to have had such a wonderful father who provided for his family and loved my mom, us kids, our kids, and great grandkids. What a testimony. I am reminded of Ephesians 2, 4 through 7. Because of your great love for me, you, God, who are rich in mercy, made me alive with Christ, even when I was dead in transgressions. It is by grace I have been saved. And you, God, raised me up with Christ and seated me with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus. I pray for God to give me my dad's courage to stand up for truth, to do the right thing. What a mighty good man, my dad. I pray that I pass on my dad's steadfast legacy of love and faith and seek God diligently. Love doesn't die, people do. I know I will die soon and look forward to seeing my dad and my heavenly family, spending eternity together. Until then, I ask the Lord to live through me so that I might be faithful.
I'm Susan, I'm child number 7. We all know what a wonderful man my dad was. That's why we're here today, to celebrate his life. I have so many fond memories, but I'm going to share what my dad taught me, the meaningful things that stay with you throughout life, the things that were effortless for my dad, things that were hard, but he knew how to raise a family with love and grace. My dad showed me how to work hard for what I wanted in life. My first car, I had to save $800 for the Volkswagen that just sat in the backyard, only for him to finally give it to me after I saved the $800. But he said I had to pay my own insurance and keep paying my own insurance. That taught me values and goals. My dad told me how to forgive. Let go of grudges, no matter how deep the hurt. Forgiveness was the only way for my mind to be clear and heal. That taught me grace. That's how my dad taught me grace. My dad helped me work through adversity. No matter how big the setback, I needed to trust in the Lord to march on and carry through. That's how my dad taught me perseverance. My dad taught me so much. We are all blessed because of the way my dad lived his life as a dedicated servant of our Lord Jesus Christ. My dad's favorite book of the Bible is Proverbs. So many life lessons in Proverbs. One of his favorite verses was Proverbs 22:6. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. My dad was never about what he had, or it was always about what he gave to others. His guidance and selflessness and love, his love for Jesus, gave us all an example of how to live our lives. I thank my dad and I miss.
I'm Kim. Thank you everyone for coming. My dad loved each person here. My dad was my hero, my role model, and the best dad a girl could have. I'm so thankful God chose my dad for me. He taught me so many life lessons, so many, but the best thing he ever taught me was to know and love Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. My dad, like everyone has said, lived his life serving others, loving people with humility and generosity. I just want to share two quick stories. My mom wanted me to share this one. When my husband and I, Tommy, were going on our first date, Tommy came to pick me up. He met my dad for the first time. And my dad said, "Son, do you have a credit card?" And Tommy was kind of scared, and he said, "Yes, sir, I do." And he said, "Good, because that girl can eat." That was my dad. And my second story is when I was 19 and I moved to Hawaii to live with Karen. Back then, I was going to the airport with my dad was taking me, but back then in the olden days for you youngins, we could walk right to the plane and you went upstairs. So my dad walked me all the way to the plane and it was time to go. I was so excited. I had been bragging, "I'm moving to Hawaii, bye." And when it came right down to it, I hugged my dad and I said, "Dad, I don't want to go. I'm scared. I want to stay with you." I started crying and he was crying and he said, "You need to go. You need to branch out and live your life." And I knew in my heart he wanted me to stay, but he knew I needed to grow up and go on my own. So now he has left this earth for home. It's hard to say goodbye, but so very thankful for the hope of heaven and God's promises to each and every one of us. And I know when my dad got to heaven, the Lord looked at my dad and said, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." We love you, Dad.
Hi, my name is Karen, and a lot of this was the same as Kathy's. So I'll skip over some of it, but I'll do most of it. I'm the third daughter, and I'm the one who's had the honor of living with my parents for the past 4.5 years. My dad was always independent. He drove until he was 92. My mom and I were relieved when he stopped because he was blind in one eye and had a few fender benders. But he also had diabetes, kidney disease, and a triple bypass, an old one, and that is finally what wore out. He longed to see Terry. He often talked about going to heaven and seeing Terry and Cheryl. I never knew anyone who looked so forward to leaving. Once I told him, I said, "Dad, you have all eternity with them. You only have a few years with us. Be patient." He goes, "I know, honey." But he was ready to go. And in fact, during the last few days, he even said, "Why is God taking so long?" And at one point, he even looked at the sky and says, "What's the holdup?" I mean, I told him, "Dad, be patient." I always thought my dad was special, but after living with him these past few years, I think he was more than amazing. He struggled with aging and getting frustrated. He can't do a lot of things, but he always had a positive attitude. He was happy and he was content and he followed all the doctor's orders. He loved watching sports, going for walks. In fact, a lot of times he'd just say, "I'm going for a walk," and walking towards the front door, and my mom's all, "Go, get your sweater, get going." So I would go and walk with him. This past year when I was laid off due to COVID, I was home with my parents, and it was during this time I made videos of my mom and dad, and I'll put those on YouTube. But I asked them, tell me about your life. I asked them questions about their marriage. So like Kathy said, they were married in 46, but when they got married, when they played in these clubs or bars, they were actually, bars basically. And they lived the party lifestyle. And my dad always wanted to have his own business. So in 1960, they moved to California.
And then in 1962, when Kim was born and the rest of us were in school, my mom just broke down. She and my dad were, I guess, getting tired of the party lifestyle. My dad was trying to always start his own business and it wasn't really going as he planned. So my mom just had basically a breakdown and realized she knew at that moment God was the answer to her problems. So she dedicated her life to God at that time. And when my dad came home from work, he asked her, well, what's going on? Because she didn't have the drink ready for him, you know? And so she told him what her experience was. And he said to her, whenever you're ready to change direction, I am too. So they both made the decision to change their lives, and that's when they started going to Arcadia Community Church. And my dad eventually rented a shop, and then his business grew, and as their faith grew, as their faith and business continued to grow, he told me that his priorities, he said it was then that his priorities changed from making money to how he could serve others. His philosophy we put in the program because that's what he worked by. And as my dad's, and you know, David always worked for my dad, and he loved that David was in the business. And by the way, I'm speaking on behalf of David too. Because David and I were the two middle ones. So we were kind of together. So what David benefited from, I benefited from. So during, like for instance, after my business and my parents changed their life, well, let me go back and just say, as my dad's business and inventory continued to grow, he needed a bigger shop and he bought the shop in South El Monte. He worked there until he retired. And yes, like Kathy said, he provided our family with camping trips to Oregon to visit my Uncle Donald and all the cousins up there. We went down to San Diego. He bought houses in Lake Arrowhead, Palm Desert, a timeshare in Hawaii. They took many cruises, many vacations. He loved golfing, boats, and even collected cars. But he would never tell you this. He was too humble. He attributed all his success, and he would always say, God has just blessed me. It was never about him being successful. In fact, when I asked him what it was to be successful, he goes, it's not about what you own or acquire, but rather knowing God and doing his will. He participated in CDMC, and like Kathy said, we always have the Gideon Bibles in the garage. And that was my first Bible, Gideon's Bible. And he did take them to high school. I mean, when we were in high school, David and I, my dad took the Bibles to Union Rescue Mission in the LA jails. A few times he told David and I want you to go with me. And so David and I were like, okay, I guess we have to go. I think he wanted to scare us because he was concerned we might not be going down the wrong path. We might not be going the right path. He had good reason to think that. So then when that didn't seem to work, he decided that David and I and my dad would get up early morning and we were gonna have early morning Bible study. So David and I and my dad studied the book of Proverbs. We woke up early and, studied Proverbs. Again, it really didn't help. David and I continued in our foolishness for years. Okay, so back to the high school days. So my memories are is when I introduced like my boyfriends to my dad, they'd come over and the first thing they'd ask is, man, is your dad a Marine sergeant? Because he had a crew cut and he was so big. I just thought, oh, if you only knew what a softy he really was. I was worried he might offer him a Gideon's Bible and start sharing about Jesus. So I was just ready to get out the door as quick as possible. And then I ran away in my junior year to Santa Rosa. I lived up there for 6 months. I was the wild, rebellious child. And after I realized I had it made at home, what a mistake, I called my parents and asked if I could come home. And my dad said, yes, of course, Karen.
So he picked me up at the airport with open arms, tears in his eyes. He was so forgiving. Then when I had my daughter, and I asked Dad, I had Ashley and I was living up in Washington. I said, I want to start a new life. I want to go to Colorado and start a new life with my daughter. Can I borrow some money? And he said, no, you can't. We want you to come home. Colorado is no place for Ashley, and that isn't the place for you. We want you to come home. That was the last thing I wanted to do. But I didn't have much of a choice, and it turned out to be one of the best moves I ever made. Her father died of cancer when she was 4, so my dad was always her double-decker daddy. I couldn't ask for a better role model. And the move was so good because I decided, let me go back to school. I was kind of easing down on the party days. Let me get my degree. So during that time, I failed algebra twice. I couldn't get through it. And my dad told me, don't give up, don't stop, you keep trying. So I did, and I finally passed and got the degree. He was such an encourager. My dad and mom never gave up on me. They continually modeled Christ's love, kindness, and forgiveness. Eventually, like him, I finally realized I needed God in my life too. Like D.L. Moody said, give your life to God. He can do more with it than you ever could. So I did. And that has made all the difference. It's not always easy, but you'll have a peace and contentment that isn't dependent on circumstances. I never forget how the few days before he died, he asked me, what are you gonna do when I go? I promised him I would take care of mom. She was his main concern. Behind every good man, there's a great woman. And in fact, his last words to me, some of his last words were, take care of your mom. I reassured him, I would, Dad, she'll be okay, I'll be with her. And then I said, maybe I'll even find work I could do from home and I'll start writing again. He looked at me and I'll never forget it. He looked at me and said, write about Jesus. That was my dad, always steering you towards God. If I asked my dad, what would you like me to say about you? He would answer, tell them about Jesus. And he would add Proverbs 3:5-6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him and he will direct your path. And how do I know this? Because he lived it.
On the cross, he sealed my part.
Maybe I should close in prayer. I love Dave. He's closer than a brother, and just the great times we've had together, the way he's loved me and our family. And we're all blessed. I remember reading a statement about 40 some years ago, said that I saw something very unusual today. He said, I saw Christ in the man. When you look at Dave, you often saw Christ in the man. Dave was not a saint. I mean, the Bible called him a saint, but he'd probably start laughing if you called him Saint Dave. And how do you take a guy from playing gigs at a bar to handing out Bibles and preaching at the gospel rescue mission? What happens? What makes that happen? Let me suggest, Dave didn't do it. You see, it wasn't about Dave. He came to a point in his life where he realized he had nothing. In fact, when they moved out here, they didn't even have a job. And there was a point where Jackie was thinking about taking her life. In fact, in the home they lived in Arcadia, she made the statement, we were so miserable. We knew we had to get out of Indianapolis. We came to Los Angeles and didn't even have a job. And she said that when we got this home, the realtor who helped us get into the home, it was a foreclosure. We didn't have enough money. We didn't know if we'd have enough money to make the next payment on the house. And my life was so miserable and I was so depressed that there was a pool out there and I thought, Cat Jackie said to herself, I don't even have the guts to drown myself in the pool. Do you see where they were? You see, you don't usually trust Christ until you realize you have a need. And when you begin to realize you have a need, then you realize there's no other place to go. They've gone everywhere else. In fact, what they began to realize is without Christ, their life sucked. I want you to look right now at the person you're sitting beside and say, without Christ, your life sucks. Okay, go ahead, just look at the person right now. Just say it. Without Christ, your life sucks. The problem is some of you don't believe that. But they believe that there's nowhere else to go. And as a result, he turned to Christ. He heard about Christ often. Jackie and Dave went to Sunday school together, memorized verses. They went to church. They heard the Bible. And yet, as they got old enough, life was... We're going to make our life. You know, Jesus said, whoever tries to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Most people are trying to save their life. In fact, most people are trying to make a life. And really what we need to do is get a life. An eternal one. Because apart from Jesus, my friend, your life does suck. I became a believer when I was 20. I wasn't looking for Christ, he was looking for me. I was literally planning on going into coaching and teaching, that's what I was gonna do. And then I began to realize though all things at that point in my life were going well, I thought there's gotta be more to life than this. There's gotta be more to life than this. So I remember Jackie saying when she came to the end of herself and Dave came home and he basically said, she said, we can't do this anymore. He said, well, if you want to do something different, let's do it together. And so she said, the verse that kept pounding in her head was in John 14:6, where it says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. And here's what's going on in John 14. Christ had lived on this earth about 33 years. He'd been in his 30 years of life. And in the 3 years of ministry, and toward the end of his ministry, he told his disciples he was going to die on a cross. And then in the midst of that, it says his disciples became filled with sorrow. And that's when he says what he says in John 14. John 14:1, he says, "Let not your heart be overcome with sorrow. Since you believe in God the Father, believe also in me." Then he told them why. He said, "In my Father's house, there are many mansions, there are many rooms, many abodes, many places to stay." You know what the New Jerusalem's all about in heaven? It's Christ going to heaven to prepare a place for us. And if you're a believer in the New Jerusalem, God's preparing a place for you. And that's exactly what happened in December. God took Dave home to a place that he's prepared for him in heaven. "Don't let your heart be overcome with sorrow. Since you believe in God the Father," he said, "believe also in me, Jesus Christ, his Son." I'm going to prepare a place for you. You see, your life's not about you. In fact, unless you get over your life, I talk to people, say, "I've got all these friends online." You don't have any friends online. You know, if your life died, how many people are coming to your funeral? Come on. You know what they're trying to find? They're trying to find just what you're trying to find. Find a life. "I'm going to prepare a place for you." And then he said this, "If I go to prepare a place for you, then I'm going to come back and take you home to be with me, that where I am, there you may be also." I love the way Jesus looked at death. He never looked at it as an end, but as a beginning. He lived for 30 years, he ministered for 3 years, and then he spent 3 days and three nights after dying on the cross in a tomb, and then he rose again. And he's in heaven preparing a place for us. That's the way he looks at death, not as an end, but as a beginning. If I go, I'm going to die, and then I'm going to rise again, and then I'm going to prepare a place for you, and if I prepare a place for you, I'm going to come back and take you home to be with me. You know, that's the way God looks at death. Death isn't the end, it's the beginning. You know, this is a pre-kindergarten class. You got it down? I'll be 73 next month. And some of you, how old are you, David? Pardon?
17.
I'm 73. Thinking about reverse those numbers around, and that's what you got here. You know, I'm about five times older than you, 4 to 5 times older than you. You know what that means? I have 4 or 5 times more sins than you do. I've lived a lot longer. You know what God's saying? He's preparing a place for us. Death isn't the end, it's the beginning. You weren't meant to live here forever. We were meant to live with Christ forever. I love the way the Bible looks at death. In fact, when I was a little kid, we used to watch these old Western movies, and when a cowboy or an Indian or somebody died, a cowboy died, they put a mirror underneath his nose. You want to know why? They just want to see if the guy was breathing, if there's any fog or breath coming out of their nose. And then I remember in the 60s, they used to say, when I was in high school, "Well, if your heart quit beating, you're dead." So then they find death by no heart activity. And now the last 20, 30 years, there's no brain activity. The problem is I know a lot of people walking around with no brain activity. And so do you. In fact, that may be you at times. It's me at times. You know how God defines death? James says, "As a body without the spirit is dead." If I were to die right now, what would happen literally is my body would fall down here on the ground because God took my soul and spirit out of my body and took me home to be with him. That's what death is. Don't be afraid of death. Christ came to destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver us through fear of death through all of our lifetimes subject to bondage. Most people are afraid to die. In fact, they don't want to think about it. They don't want to go to funerals. And we live in a culture that's all about fearing of death, and they don't want to go there. They don't want to talk about it. You see, death is not your enemy, my friend. If you know Christ, it's your friend. I'm going to prepare a place for you. So when God comes here and takes your soul and spirit, whether you're 17 or whether you're 71 or whether you're 53 or whether you're 29, it doesn't matter. When you die, God's taking your soul and spirit home to be with him if you're a believer. And then Thomas said, Lord, we don't know where you're going. We've never been to heaven. How can we know the way? And in a very simple statement, Jesus said three things that he wants us to know. I know Dave wants you to know. He said, Thomas, I'm the way. You know what the word way is? It's a walk. It's a road. It's a path. It's an aisle. That's what it is. I'm the way. Last couple weeks, I've had two different men. One I've known fairly well for a while, a number of years. One I didn't know at all, basically. One guy said, I've lost my way, Rich. Have you lost your way? Are you on the wrong path? The verse that's in your bulletin, develop, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Don't lean on your understanding. You know, if your brains were dynamite, you probably couldn't blow your nose. Don't lean on your understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. We need direction. Otherwise, you're going to get sucked up into life, living for a home, or living for a car, or living for a job, or living for retirement. And living for what you get. Get all you can and count all you get, and then you're dead. Then what? If you kept living your life the way you're living it now, would it matter that you lived? Are we just using up oxygen, or is there a purpose in life? I'm the way. In fact, in the book of Acts, sometimes one of the names for the early Christians or the church was the way, the followers of the way. The way was Jesus. There was a different way. Different way than I was living. Different way than you're living. Christ is the way. Thomas, I'm the way. I'm the road. You don't have to make your own road. You don't have to make your own way. When you trust Jesus, he makes the way for you. You know what? The utter relief of holiness and knowing God. You no longer have to make your way in life. He makes way for you. Isn't that great? Because if your life sucks, then you know that means your way sucks too. Your way. You see, the issue isn't whether you're Buddhist or Baptist or Muslim or Methodist or Catholic or Christian. That's not the issue. Christ is far different than all of that. The issue is, do you know Jesus? Does he know you? Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice, I know them, I give them eternal life, they will never perish. No one can take them out of my hand. The Father who gave them to me is greater than all, and no one can take them out of my Father's hand. I'm the way. Secondly, he said, I'm the truth. You know, Christ spoke the truth. What he said came to pass. People knew they could trust him. Can you be trusted? Is your word true? I know Dave and I were talking one time about, boy, in the old days, you didn't have to shake hands. Your word was your bond. You said it and you did it. That means nothing today. Your word was your bond. You said it, you're going to do it. Even if it hurt you, you're going to do it. Christ spoke the truth. Isn't it great to know somebody you can totally trust in? I'm the truth. He left us the truth in a little book called the Bible. I saw a bumper sticker one day years ago. It said, read the Bible, it'll scare the hell out of you. I love that bumper sticker. I'm the truth. But most of all, you know what Jesus said? I'm the life. You want life, my friend, you need Jesus. Otherwise, all you have is just a life. One of the Greek words for life is bios, so another one is zoe. Some people just have a biological life. They don't have a life factor in them. I am the life. Everywhere Christ went, he gave life. He often fed the hungry. He healed the sick. I love it when Jesus attended funerals. You know, we have about four examples in the New Testament when Christ attended a funeral. He ruined everyone. You know how you ruin a funeral? You just raise a person from the dead, right on the spot. But Dave's ashes, are they with us here?
We forgot them.
You forgot them? Things haven't changed. You guys always forget Dave.
My mom doesn't like to look at them.
Your mom doesn't like to look at them. They're just his ashes. The nut's gone home. The shell's here, okay? He's with Jesus. Okay. They're just ashes.
I knew I forgot.
No, don't worry about what you forgot. You know, Dave's always forgotten. Wasn't he the one that's always forgotten? That says a lot. I mean, not about you, Karen. That's not my point here. Because Dave did so much and gave so much and loved so much, most people didn't think about Dave. Until they needed something or wanted something or had to go somewhere for something. Well, I can trust in Dave. He's going to do that. And I'm not saying that negatively. I'm saying that positively. But God doesn't forget. God doesn't forget. God knows. I'm the life. He's the embodiment of life. When Jesus attended a funeral, the four funerals he attended, he raised them from the dead right on the spot. How would you like to be at a funeral? There's a casket right there. The person's been dead for 4 days or a week or whatever. Our cremains are right there. And all of a sudden, boom, this guy comes out. Lazarus, come out. Somebody said, had Jesus been at that graveyard and not said, Lazarus, come out. Had Jesus just said, come out, everybody in the grave would have come out. Why? He's God. He's God in the flesh. He's God in the flesh. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Christ is the embodiment of life, my friends. You want to hear the five good F words? When you get down here today, you can say F you, but you say it this way, my friend. Okay? The five good F words is this. The first good F word is salvation's by God's favor. The most distinctive word in Christianity is grace. No other religious system has a concept of grace. None. All religious systems are basically how you work your way up to get to heaven or nirvana or wherever you're going to go. If there's any place, some religions, there's no place. This life just ends it. That's fine till you die. Grace. You know what grace is? It's God's favor. It's unmerited favor. It's just God giving you something you didn't deserve, you didn't work for, you couldn't earn it. God just saved you. It's by grace. It's God's favor. The second F word is salvation is free. Dave knew that. When he finally trusted the Lord as a kid and then now as a young adult, finally came to grips with life, he knew it was all about the freedom of what Jesus was giving him as a gift. He knew it was gifted to him. You see, you know how good you have to be to get to heaven? Perfect. You catch it? You know what that means? We're not going. Yeah. You know how good you have to be to get to heaven? You got to be perfect. Well, how are you going to get there? You're not getting there through your perfection. You're getting there through Christ's perfection. Aren't you glad? It's not about the church. It's not about baptism or communion or money or being miticized or circumcised or homogenized or whatever it is. It's not about that. It's all about Jesus, the perfect Lamb of God. You see, salvation is not only by favor, it's free. It's a gift. And right there where you're seated this afternoon or this morning, all you have to say in your heart of hearts is recognize the need that there's a hole in your heart that only Christ can fill. And if he doesn't fill it, you're going to be empty. No job, no money, no house, no car, no spouse, no husband, no wife. Nobody will ever be able to fill it because nobody will ever be enough and you'll never be enough. Did you ever listen to that song about not being enough in The Greatest Showman? What a great song. Not enough. You're never going to be enough, my friend. But Christ is more than enough. He's more than enough. He's more than enough. It's free. Salvation is a free gift of God. For by grace are you saved through faith. It's not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. Dave never was bragging about himself. He always bragged about Jesus. The third F word is salvation by faith. You just have to trust him. You have to accept him. It's not about some religious spiel. It's about the reality of Jesus. Faith makes the invisible visible, the intangible tangible, the impossible possible. That's what faith does. It's all by faith. Believing Christ, taking him at his word and believing him, just trusting him alone. Not you in the church or you and you or you in Christ and you in baptism and Christ in baptism or Christ and anything else. It's Christ alone. It's all about Jesus, what he did for you. It's by faith. The fourth F word is forgiveness. You know what it means to be forgiven? It means to be your sins to be all erased. The word forgiveness, the New Testament, and the word divorce are the same root words. It means to send away. And when Christ died for our sins on the cross, he said, it's finished. He died for my sins and they're all sent away. They're erased. They're never held against me. Aren't you glad? You're forgiven. You're accepted. That's what it means. Because you're forgiven. Everyone needs to be forgiven. Forgiven. The last F word is salvation's forever. God's not in heaven, and God's not saying about me, I love him, I love him not, I love him, I love him not. But I hope when I die, it's on the, I love him. Because if when I die, it's I love him not, I'm screwed. That's not the way it works, my friend. That's not the way it works at all. Want to know how much Christ loves you? Look at the cross. I remember years ago, I was a young pastor about 45 years ago, and I was talking to a man, and he actually brought up the topic of God. And I started talking to him about Christ. He said, where was God when my son died in Vietnam? You know what God just gave me, so I didn't, it came out of my mouth, but I don't know where it came from. I said, you want to know where he was? The same place he was when his son died on the cross. That's where he was. So Jesus loves you. He died your death. He rose again to give you life, and if you trust in him, his goodness is your goodness, and his perfection is your perfection. And his grace is your grace, and his love is your love. You see, my friend, since there was nothing you could do to cause God, or nothing you did to cause God to love you in the first place, there's nothing you can do to cause God to stop loving you now. Did you catch it? People are dying for love. The average person has no clue. They're wandering around this world wondering if anybody even loves them or cares for them. I deal a lot with young marrieds and young couples, and they often think they're going to find their life in their partner. You know, let me say something to you guys. There's no woman in the world who could totally meet your needs. You want to know why? You're too much for any woman. And all the guys say, yeah, I thought that. There's no woman in the world who can totally meet your needs. You're too much for any woman. God's made you too much. And ladies, don't get married. Think you're marrying that knight in shining armor. His armor will start rusting the first day you're married. You see, ladies, there's no man in the world who can totally meet your needs, because there's no man who's enough. You're not even enough. If Christ doesn't meet your needs, you're going to be empty. Ladies, you're just too much for any man. Our life is so complex and there's so much, and yet in the simplicity of Jesus, we find a God who loves us. And this is where Christianity is different. The real Christianity is different from all other religions. No other religion has a concept of a God literally coming down, becoming what we were, so we can become what he is. All religious systems are how you work your way up to Buddha or Allah or Nirvana or somebody else or somewhere else. Where real Christianity is how God worked his way down. He literally came down to this earth to take us to be with him forever. The God of heaven became a man. His name's Jesus. He lived, he loved, he died. But he said this, if you destroy my body, in 3 days I will raise myself from the dead. He said, I didn't die a victim. He said, nobody takes my life from me. I give it down. I give it. I have power to lay it down. I have power to bring it back from the dead. I know some of you think, where do you get this stuff? I got it from Jesus. That's where I got it. I pretty well know what Dave wanted me to say, even though he didn't tell me what to say at all. And Dave's heart is going out to all of your hearts. If all you're doing is living your life or trying to find a life, my friend Dave's praying for you. He wants you to find what he never had before until he found Jesus. And when he found him, he had a real disease. And when you have Christ, you have nothing to prove. You have nothing to live up to. When you have Christ for the first time, you're free in your life to be what God's called you to be. And now you can love Jesus and just live for him. See, Christianity is not about doing all these things for God. Often the work of God I'm doing is destroying the work of God in me. Real Christianity is vibrant. It's what Christ did for you and what now he's doing in you. So it's not about your life. It's about Christ's life in you. In fact, my friend, let me say it this way. People have seen enough of you. Don't need to see any more of you. unless we're seeing Christ in you. That make sense? People see enough of you. Now it's Jesus in you. So let me ask you a question. What are you going to do? How would you like it if you're dating one of Dave's daughters and a guy pulls up to the door and knocks on the door and Dave's asking if he's got a Bible? Oh boy, you got to be kidding. What kind of weird family is this? Dave left Jesus. It may not always come across the way you wanted it to, but he left Jesus. And he wants you to love Jesus. You see, when you understand the real Christ, it's not what you find in most books and most religious interpretations of Christ. Christ is compelling. He's inviting. He's authentic. He's vulnerable. He's transparent. He has nothing to prove. He's not trying to fool anybody into anything. He's not selling anything. I run into a lot of pastors. All they are is salesmen with religious garb. I love about Jesus, he wasn't trying to sell anybody anything. He just loved people. And when the people saw it, they knew they were loved. And they knew they could be forgiven and accepted. And they knew, here was a person who knew everything I ever did. And yet he still loves me. And he accepts me and he forgives me. So as you reflect on Dave, reflect on what made him different. And it was Christ. He loved Jesus. He's with Jesus. Ephesians 2:6 says that we're seated in the heavenlies, and throughout the ages to come, God's going to continually show us the riches of his kindness and his grace through Christ Jesus. Not hour after hour, day after day, month after month, year after year, but age after age. If you don't have a life, I would say get one, an eternal one, where you have nothing to prove, nothing to try to be. I've had people say, I can live up to that, Rich. I can go to church. I can live. If people knew what I was like, God already knows what you're like. He says, just trust me that I can do something you could never do for yourself. That's grace. So what are you going to do with it? I invite you this morning to trust Jesus. He loves you. He died for you. He rose again for you. And just as he saved Dave, he can step into your life and he can make a difference and he can cause you to stop living to make a life and start living to make a difference. That's what really matters. Let's bow our hearts and heads in prayer. Father, I thank you for Dave. I just love this guy. It's great to have been loved by him and knowing that he still loves me. I thank you, Lord, that Jesus is inviting. He is compelling. Not the interpretation we have of all kinds of people about what kind of person Christ was. I mean, talking about the God of the Bible who literally became a man to show us in human terms what it means to live well, what it means to die well, what it means to love people and forgive people and deliver them from fear. So right now, Lord, I would just pray if there's someone here this morning, because maybe you heard about God or maybe you never heard about God, right there where they're seated, recognizing a hole in their heart that only Christ can fill, may they do what Dave did 72 years ago. Got on his knees and just said, Lord, help me, because you are the way, the truth, and the life. Thank you for Dave. Thank you for living a light in our lives and giving us the love of God through Dave. And may all of his children, his grandchildren, his loved ones, other relatives, and his friends realize they saw something different in a man today. I saw Christ in Dave. Thank you for the privilege of knowing him and blessing us with your life in his life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.